Tiny technology, hepatic tissue engineering, and cancer nanotechnology. What is hepatic engineering and cancer nanotechnology? Hepatic tissue engineering is a step towards alleviating the need for donor organs, specifically livers, yet many challenges must be overcome. Some of these challenges include where the cell will attach, cell source, and immunological barriers. Hepatic engineering allows us to mimic the structure of the liver and sustain functional and viable hepatocytes, also known as liver cells. Expanding and improving upon this platform technology will allow advancements to be made and will continue towards the development of a fully functioning and implantable liver. Bioreactors have aided in hepatocyte survival and have proven to sustain viable cells for several weeks. Nanotechnology offers the means to target chemotherapies directly and selectively to cancer cells and neoplasms, guide in surgical resection of tumors, and enhance the therapeutic efficacy of radiation-based and other current treatment modalities. Nanotechnology can also provide rapid detection of cancer-related molecules and can possibly detect cancer earlier, even when they only occur in a small percentage of cells. Cancer nanotechnology has the potential to generate entirely novel and highly effective therapeutic agents. Why is it important in the healthcare field? The reason why it's so important in the healthcare field is because there are 500 million patients who live with liver dysfunctions, with 2 million worldwide deaths each year. This puts a massive strain on the healthcare system as the list of organ donors continues to grow and sheds light on the disparities in the healthcare system, especially in the time of a pandemic. The reduction in transplants translated to 48,239 waitlisted patient life years lost. Delaying life-saving surgeries also affects the lower class, as patients with transplanted livers have less access to rejection medication due to a lack of insurance, causing the individual to have a lower chance of survival even with a new organ. This important research can help people in these situations by reducing the risk of transplanted liver and host. What is the purpose of studying the two-dimensional hepatic microenvironment? Well, it allows for the study of the architecture of this organ by creating an artificial microenvironment in this organ in 2D. It does so by patterning surfaces with lights and biomolecules that will confer the adhesion of cells. It can pattern many different cells, such as a single cell to a bow tie of two cells to an asymmetric multicellular island. This uses very generic tools to study a two-dimensional system. This is an example of using 2D hepatic microenvironment to explore the importance of the malaria liver stage in P. vivax eradication. In the clinical context, P. vivax has devastating effects, with greater than one-third of the global population at risk, 9 million cases globally in 2017, and more than 70% of cases are due to P. vivax in countries with less than 5,000 cases per year. P. vivax turns out to be a relapsing form of malaria, and thus it is difficult to eradicate. But how does this come to be? Well, it starts with a sporozoite from an infected mosquito, which travels to the liver where it infects hepatocytes, and then it multiplies over 7 to 10 days. Soon, it bursts out of the liver and infects young red blood cells known as reticulocytes, and then starts the pattern of cyclic fever which we associate with malaria. One technique they use in this experiment is known as multi-pattern co-cultures, also known as MPCC. What occurs is they pattern human hepatocytes from organ donors on collagen type 1. They use this technique to manipulate and maintain the human hepatocyte's phenotype in a two-dimensional construct at the bottom of the well for 4 to 6 weeks, depending on the donor, as it studies the living stage of pathogens. It allows for miniaturizing these micro-patterned co-cultures in a way that they can be put into multi-well plates. To better understand this technique, think of it as making stamps, where essentially MPCC is stamping into multi-well plates. As for how the experiment unfolded, it starts with the portability of the MPCC. The researcher in this study patterned the plates in Boston, then waited for the rainy season in Thailand, where P. vivax is endemic. Then they flew with the cells frozen and the plates to a collaborator lab in Thailand, where the researchers there had collected blood from infected P. vivax patients in the field. They then fed that to the mosquitoes and then isolated sporozoites from the mosquitoes and put it into the cell culture. They put it into the MPCC, and then the experiment lasted for 21 days. The plates were then brought back to Boston to use machine algorithms to study the parasites. The other plates were in collaboration with another lab at MIT to do single-cell sequencing of the infected hepatocytes. So, what were the key findings? Well, they explored the P. vivax development in MPCCs, and what they found was that at the beginning, all the parasites were quite small. Around day 8, after letting them grow, we can see that some of the parasites are small and some have replicated. There was also remarkable cellular rearrangement, where in the culture you can see they are up to 130 microns, so they take up the whole hepatocyte cytoplasm and squish up against the nucleus. Around day 10, this was the first time anyone saw these results in vitro, where the structure was bursting out and there were merozoites streaming out of the hepatocytes, and then they entered into the blood stage. After 21 days, small persistent forms, known as hypnozoites, were seen. However, there are no known biomarkers for hypnozoites, so researchers used the four clinical hallmarks to describe and determine if those forms were hypnozoites. All of the four clinical hallmarks were seen, such as the forms were small, inactive, mononuclear, and persisting. They did not express mature markers like merozoite surface protein. They were differentially drug sensitive, and last but not least, dormant forms are capable of reactivating. Dr. Bhatia and her team also conducted an experiment that was done within a 3D hepatic microenvironment. This experiment was conducted to study in vitro how human hepatocyte endothelial interactions relate to regeneration using 3D tools. Dr. Bhatia and her team took human hepatocytes and made spheroids using microfabricated mold. They created a microchip that has a channel in the middle containing human endothelial cells and spheroids around them. They noticed that hepatocytes enter the cell cycle in the presence of prostaglandin E2. The cells no longer cycle as they are dependent on prostaglandin E2 in the endothelial cells. They found that in the presence of IL-1 beta but absence of prostaglandin E2, the cells do not cycle. IL-1 beta induced cycling is dependent on prostaglandin E2 from endothelial cells, and endothelial cells, human liver regeneration, are making prostaglandin E2 and contributing to hepatocyte cell cycle entry. Dr. Bhatia and her team conducted a similar experiment in vivo. They made an implantable version of the chip, put it inside the intraperitoneal space of the mouse where they can manipulate the liver. A partial hepatectomy was done and the hepatocytes enter into cell cycle and the liver regrows. Once the mouse liver regrew, the regenerative stimulus went away. They redid the experiment in a different type of mouse to have a more lasting effect. What were the key findings? About 5% of the hepatocytes enter into cell cycle. This experiment had a transient effect because when the mouse liver regrew, the regenerative stimulus went away. They also found that hepatocytes expand and reorganize after injury. Another application of nanotechnology is for the purpose of cancer detection. The tumor microenvironment refers to the environment surrounding a tumor cell, including the blood vessels, extracellular matrix, and immune cells in the local region. Early detection of tumors is important as this leads to better patient outcomes. Some detection methods that are currently used include mammograms, which screen for breast cancer, colonoscopies, which can detect colon cancers, and liquid biopsies, which can detect cancer products in the blood. However, it is difficult to determine if a person has a tumor very early on using these methods because the signals that indicate cancer are very limited. Nanotechnology can be used to detect cancers early on, and this new technique makes use of proteases. Proteases are enzymes which are active in tumor microenvironments, and this activity can be used to detect the presence of tumors. Tiny nanoparticles carry peptides, which are small proteins, and can be delivered to the tumor microenvironment through the blood. The nanoparticles leak out of the blood vessels once they reach the tumor, and here they can be activated by the local proteases. The proteases cleave off of the peptides that are carried by the nanoparticles, and these peptides can be eliminated from the body through the bloodstream. One protease interacts with one nanoparticle and cleaves many peptides from the surface of the nanoparticle. Thus, one protease results in many peptides being returned to the bloodstream, resulting in amplification of the signal. The peptides in the blood are then filtered through the kidneys, and these peptides can be detected in the urine. This method of detecting tumors can have many different applications. Rapid tests, similar to the ones used to detect COVID-19, can be developed. This can be adapted for lung cancers as well, resulting in the development of breathalyzers that can detect exhaled particles that are indicative of lung cancer. Finally, once the presence of the tumor is detected, it can be then located using imaging techniques such as PET. Once tumors are detected and located, patients can then be treated, resulting in better outcomes and even remission of cancer. If you are interested in learning more, check out the following sources for more information.